Let me just mention, in fact, maybe I'll do the demo of this barn. Let's turn out all the lights. Yeah, maybe I should even shut the door. Now, this is a green laser. The problem with green lasers is that they're not really green. They're mostly infrared. And the infrared photons are frequency doubled. And so green lasers often emit a very strong ray of infrared light and can be dangerous. So make sure you don't point an infrared laser at anybody. I'm going to redo the demo that I did in the class, the Wednesday class, for you. So here is, I hope, just ordinary water, and I'm planning to drink it. And you see the laser light goes through without, I should have taken the plastic off this, without actually scattering. But here's a red, oh, I forgot to take the laser, the light off that one also. But you see now this one, the green light comes through and then it gets converted to yellow. Let me see, does somebody have either a pocket knife or a really sharp fingernails? Hold on, let me turn the light on. I can maybe use a key. Looks nicer when you can see the whole thing. So these are fluorophores, and fluorophores are molecules that absorb photons and then go into an excited state and then come back down and emit other light. This is a red highlighter that I managed to get somewhat dissolved into the water. And so you see the green photons go in, they excite the red highlighter molecules, and these then emit light in that's yellow. I can show you the other two. This is, this one, I forget which one this is. This one I think also is a, this is a yellow highlighter, or maybe orange. And then one of these hardly worked at all. It's a little bit, but, and by comparison, you can see that if, by comparison, you can see that when the light goes through ordinary water, it's almost completely transparent apart from, I guess, the arsenic and other minerals in New Mexican water. That's just an example of fluorophores. These are used a lot in biophysics, and they became particularly useful when a chemist in California figured out how to make proteins, how to convert proteins into fluorophores, because then what you can do is what you can do is put the DNA for a protein in the genome of an organism, and then the organism will when it produces a particular protein, it will also produce the fluorophore connected to it, and you can pick which protein you put the DNA for the fluorophore next to, so you can make different proteins in an organism glow with different colors when they're illuminated. Okay, so back in the world of Fourier and Laplace transforms, we stopped. Unfortunately, I didn't mark this one. We finished convolutions and we did Laplace transforms, derivatives of Laplace transforms. And the next topic, I didn't do Laplace transforms and differential equations, did I?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, so let's start with that. So suppose P is some polynomial in derivatives, and we apply that to a Laplace transform of, well, we apply that to a function, and we want that to, we want to solve that differential equation. So that's an ordinary differential equation, and it could be of reasonably high order. Well, then you're going to let f of s be a Laplace transform of something else, e to the minus st big F of t dt, and let us say j of s is going to be an integral 0 to infinity e to the minus st big J of t dt. And so then the differential equation is p of d by ds acting on f of s is an integral 0 to infinity of e to the minus st p of minus t times f of t dt, and we want that to be integral e to the minus st j of t dt. And so you can see there's an algebraic solution there, namely, you just say f of t equals to j of t divided by p of minus t. So this is analogous to what we did with Fourier transforms in a simple case. Yes?
What is p? The p of d?
P is, well, in general, it could be quite an arbitrary function, but I'm thinking of it as just a polynomial in derivatives. Okay. And those, and there might be other things, constants in the simplest cases, but it could be that there, it could be that P has some S's involved also. But then it would be a little tricky because there'd be S dependence here, and you would then want to say that f of t was j of t. You don't want S dependence here. So let us say this thing is just a polynomial in derivatives with constant coefficients. Great question. Better catch. Okay, so we then have a solution then, namely f of s is equal to integral 0 to infinity e to the minus st j of t divided by p of minus t dt. And what one would want also, though, would be if you want to solve this in general, you also need solutions of the homogeneous equation, P of dds, f of s is equal to zero. And one way of doing that is to set the homogeneous function, and maybe I should have written the homogeneous solution, f sub h of s, equal to an integral 0 to infinity e to the minus st, and now have this p of t will come through. We'll fix it this way. Delta of p of minus t, h of t, dt. This thing is more or less arbitrary, and the reason this works is this p of dds on fh of s, h referring to this h, will be an integral 0 to infinity e to the minus st, p of minus t, delta of p of minus t, h of t dt, and now, how do I want to say this? This is, in other words, just as x delta of x is identically zero or suitably zero, this delta has support only when p is zero, and so the whole thing is zero as long as h is reasonably regular. I remember I once showed this to a mathematician and said that this was one way of getting homogeneous solutions to the homogeneous equation, and he said, homogeneous equation, that space is vast. And in fact, you can see the space is vast because this is virtually an arbitrary function, as long as it's reasonably regular. Okay, so the total solution then is...
I have a question about this.
Yes.
So like, what are we assuming that we were like, given? I don't know, do we know f of s, and then we have to sort of like, look for what...
No, you don't know f of s. You express f of s as a Fourier transform, and then you solve for f of t. I'm solving for f of t. Let me just write down the answer to this problem. The solution then is f of s equals integral 0 to infinity e to the minus st j of t over p of minus t plus plus delta of p of minus t times a virtually arbitrary function h of t dt. So that's the solution. This solves the inhomogeneous equation, and then this is a fairly general solution of the homogeneous equation. Okay, now let me tell you about inverting a Laplace transform. In other words, if we're given a Laplace transform, f of s is integral 0 to infinity dt e to the minus st f of t, and we know f of s, how do we find f of t? So this is the inverse of Laplace transform. The Fourier transform, bingo, you just change I to minus I and do the integral. The way you do it is first you extend
the Fourier transform from a real variable to a complex variable. And then this is an integral 0 to infinity dt, e to the minus s plus iu t f of t. And now here I'm choosing, remember the Fourier the Laplace transform gets better and better behaved as you increase s, the real part of s. And so you need to choose f of s, you need to choose s big enough so that f of s is well behaved
before you do this trick. And now what you do is you pray to Dirac, and he comes down and helps you. What you do is you do an integral from minus infinity to plus infinity, du over 2 pi, e to the iut, f of s plus iu. Okay, so that over here then is an integral du over 2 pi, minus infinity to plus infinity, integral 0 to infinity dt, I'm changing t to t prime here, dt prime e to the, right, now I've got these variables. Yeah, I changed that t to t prime, and this is iut. So we have here iut, and then this one is e to the minus s plus iu times t, and then all that is f of t, and f of t prime, and this is a prime. Okay, so this t over here is there, that t. Okay, now you see you've got a u in common, and integrating du over 2 pi, that just gives us the delta function. So this is an integral 0 to infinity dt prime delta of t minus t prime e to the minus s t prime f of t prime. And of course that gives us e to the minus s t f of t. Okay. So once again Dirac has saved the day. So the solution then is the inversion of the Laplace transform is e to the s t times this. In other words, e to the st times the integral from minus infinity to plus infinity du over 2 pi e to the iut f of s plus iu. I've simplified slightly the treatment in the book. Yeah, I saw there was something that was unnecessary, so I dropped it. This particular integral is called a Bromwich integral. Some people call it a Fourier-Mellon integral. Anyway, that's how you invert a Laplace transform. Let's see, let me turn and pass around the attendance sheet. And if we go in alphabetical order. And please print your last name, not middle name, first name, nickname. Okay, last name, and please print. Okay, applications of differential equations. So here, I again want to have d1, d2, dn on f of x1, x2, xn equal to, let us say, g of x1, x2, xn. And of course here, dj is partial xj. And I'm thinking that this has constant coefficients, so that's the simple case. And I'm going to write f, let me now use x as the variable, f of x as an integral, f tilde of k, e to the I, k1 x1 plus kn xn, dn k, and the same thing for g. So I'm just, g of x is integral g tilde k1 through kn e to the I k dot x dn k. So all the integrals go. Now, where do the integrals go? You put the integrations where they do the most good. And for example, if you could let k run from infinity, minus infinity, and then these are Fourier transforms. You could let k go from 0 to I infinity. And that means you'd be going up the imaginary k-axis, and then these things would be Laplace transforms. Okay, so you could do it either way. And however you do it, dmj on f of x will be integral f tilde of all the k's ikj raised to the m power e to the I k dot x dnk. Okay. So that's how the derivatives act. And so then you've got, you do it here, p of d1 dot 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 dn on f of x1 xn is then going to be an integral f tilde of all the k's. P will just be p of ik e to the I k dot x dn k, and we can write that as in the Fourier law or Laplace space as e to the I k dot x dnk. And so what do we have? We have as a result an algebraic equation, namely that f tilde of k times p of ik should be g tilde of k. And so we can then write the solution of the inhomogeneous equation, f sub I of x, let us say, as integral e to the I k dot x g tilde of k over p of I k dnk. So that's the solution of the inhomogeneous equation. Anyway, it's turned on, right? Important. And now we can add in the solution of the homogeneous equation by just adding to this another term, which will be e to the I k dot x delta of p of ik a for k
dnk.
So this gives the homogeneous solution, because when you operate on it with p of p of the derivatives, that just pulls down p of ik here, p of ik delta by k of zero. H is just is essentially an arbitrary smooth function, but of course, how shall I say? The general solution to a differential equation is a particular solution of the inhomogeneous equation. That's this one. And then the general solution of the homogeneous equation. So you want to consider here an essentially an arbitrary function of H there. Okay, then. All right. Now, I see I have various examples here. I'm not really sure how many of these examples, or which of these examples to do in class. So let me sort of get an idea of how you feel. One is to apply these ideas to a scalar field and in a quantum field, or first just a classical field, and then generalize it to a quantum field. Generalization is instantaneous, which maybe is something we should worry about. But so there's that. Then there's the same thing translated into a Fourier series, and then there's the example on diffusion. So, for those of you who want to do quantum optics, the quantized scalar field might be useful, because the electromagnetic field is kind of like four scalar fields. But I don't know. So, who wants one? What examples do you want before we go into chapter four?
I'd like to see the first one.
You want to see what?
The first one.
All right. All right, let's, anybody else? Okay, so the wave equation for a scalar field is grad squared minus d by dt squared minus m squared on the field. X here is t spatial x. This, by the way, is sometimes written as triangle minus d by dt squared minus m squared phi. And since that's triangle and there's a fourth derivative, some people write this as box minus m squared phi. And of course, this notation is preferred by people who are lazy, and most people are lazy, and so this is often used for that. And I'm doing this, I think, yes, in units where h bar and c are 1. So these are so-called natural units. And the deal with natural units is you just set h bar and c equal 1, do the calculation, and you finally get to an answer. You take out, you imagine that the h bar is salt and the c is pepper, and you sprinkle your answer with salt and pepper until you get the units right. And works every time. And I think it was Feynman who pushed back, made that popular, but I'm not even sure. I met Feynman a couple of times. David lived in his Okay, so, phi of x, let's write it as a Fourier transform. But we're writing it as a four-dimensional Fourier transform to start with. Okay, now, and this k dot x, let me just say what k dot x is here. It is k vector dot x vector minus k zero t, k zero being the energy. Well, it's, we're integrating over all values of k. Yes?
I just want to, in the book it says it's a flat space-time. Does that just mean there's no
gravity? Yeah. We're not doing general relativity here. I'm not much of a teacher. Flat space-time just means we're ignoring gravity. By the way, the New York Times reported today that the LIGO collaboration, which now includes Virgo, which is a European gravitational wave detector, discovered a new collision, a new collapse of two black holes. And in this case, three solar masses were converted to energy, which went out as a gravitational wave. And the energy of that gravitational wave was more than the output, the energy output at that moment of all the stars in the known universe. So it's an absolutely colossal amount of energy. On the other hand, gravity, the gravitational, as you know, when you, if you hold two objects together, you don't feel them pulling on each other. The gravitational attraction is very weak, unless you're dealing with a planet-sized object mass, and so that gravitational wave goes through the universe and, you know, does essentially no damage. It stretches things a little bit this way while squeezing them that way, and then stretches them this way and squeezes them that way, but the amount of the effect is essentially negligible. I think this was 1.6 billion light years away. So it basically happened something like that, more than 30 years ago. Anyway. And because they now have three detectors, one in Louisiana, one in Washington, and one in, I think it's Italy, but I'm not sure. Somewhere in Europe, or Italy, thank you. They were able to triangulate it more or less, and they know where in the sky it came from. When they just had two detectors, if you look at the, if you map the sky this way, with two detectors they had something like that. With Virgo they now have something like that. And so they know where it was coming from. All right, let's apply then this differential operator to the scale of field, and we want to get zero. So what do we get? Let me write it this way because it's so much simpler. This would then be an integral. Grad squared brings down a minus k squared. Then we have k0 squared, and we have then minus m squared e to the I k dot x phi tilde of k t fourth k over 2 pi, not 2 pi over 4, 2 pi squared. Okay, so the algebraic equations, this is just a homogeneous one. Algebraic equations minus k squared plus k zero squared minus m squared phi tilde of k has to be zero. And so what we're gonna do is we're gonna say that phi of x is integral delta of minus k squared plus k zero squared minus m squared e to the I k dot x, arbitrary function h of k, as long as it's not too singular, t4 k over 2 pi squared. Okay, so this is an application of this homogeneous technique. And now, the argument of the delta function is what I was calling there p of I k, and this is, why did I switch sign? Okay, well, the delta function is even, and I didn't switch sign. I'm just rewriting this. I'm just putting the positive term first. So that's p of I k. We can write that as k0 minus square root of k squared plus m squared, k0 plus square root k squared plus m squared. Okay. This has zeros at k0 equal to plus or minus, obviously, square root of k squared plus m squared. This is the energy of the particle, mass m, momentum k. And we call this plus or minus omega sub k. Okay, now, on the other hand, you know that when you have a delta function of a function, it's equal to delta functions of the zeros divided by the absolute value of the derivative of the function. And the derivative of the function, in this case, d of p at plus or minus omega k, dk0, the absolute value of this is 2 omega k. So in other words, d by dk0 is 2k0, k0 is plus or minus omega k. And you take the absolute value. So that means that we can do the integral over k0, and we just pick up this function evaluated at k0 equal to plus or minus omega k. We have to divide by 2 omega k, and omega being positive, and we have h then at those values of k. And so this, the scale field in phi of x is an integral e to the I k dot x minus omega k t, that's k0. Then we have that, and then we have h plus of k plus e to the I k dot x plus omega k t, h minus of k. And now we're left with d cubed k over 2 pi squared 2 omega k. And now, imagine that this function is real or Hermitian. Then, what we know from our analysis of Fourier transforms, h minus k is equal to h plus, h minus of minus k has to be h plus of k complex conjugate. And if it's a Hermitian field, then h minus of minus k is equal to h dagger plus of k. And so what we do is we simply say a of k will be h plus of k, and for convenience, someone's convenience, I don't know who,
we divide by an extra factor of square root of 4 pi omega k. And then, now this A then is called an annihilation operator. And let me see. I forgot to say that because omega k is an even function of 3 vector k, this thing being 3 vector k, we can flip this to minus k. In other words, we can write this as minus k dot x. And then we have to change that because we're not changing this sign. And now we put in a minus sign there. But h minus of minus k is h star of h plus. And so what we finally get then is an integral e to the I k dot x minus omega k t a of k plus e to the minus I k dot x minus omega k t a dagger of k. This is for the Hermitian case. All that times, and now it's dqk over 2 pi, well, it's square root of 2 pi cubed 2 omega k. Okay, so that's the final result for the field. This is called the annihilation operator, this is the creation operator. And the commutation relations that they satisfy, let me not go through, I don't think, any more of this. Let me just tell you what the commutation relations are. It's a three-dimensional delta function of k minus k prime. So for photons, it's essentially the same thing as that you have. For each momentum, you have two possible polarizations. And you then also have a polarization vector of four components. Okay, I think that's enough for that. Let me just tell you what the result is. If we want to now write this as a Fourier series, we have a sum over k, 1 over square root of 2 omega k v, volume of the box that we're putting the universe into, a sub k, e to the I, k dot h minus omega k t, plus a k dagger. And this is often written as just e to the minus kx, meaning the same thing as that. Now the sum over these k's, k vector here is 2 pi over l times some integer, a 3 vector of integers. And now the commutation relations for these are delta of k and k prime. So these are Kronecker deltas, one or zero. And all right, I think that's enough of that example. Do you guys want to see the diffusion example, or should I skip it?
Sure.
How many want to do biophysics? Nobody. All right, let me tell you guys something. Biophysics is a field that is really expanding rapidly.
lots of jobs, good salaries, and you have the chance of advancing medicine, which is important. You guys are also young. You think medicine is like car insurance, something that you don't really need, but in fact, so should I skip it or not? All right, you can read about it. It's in the book. So let me switch now to the fourth chapter. We're talking about infinite series, and first thing I want to do is go through some definitions, and these things, I imagine you've seen a lot of these things as undergraduates. We have S sub n as n sum, n equals 0 to capital N, C sub n. We say that this converges to a number S as n goes to infinity, if, of course, S minus S sub n is less than epsilon as long as n is greater than some n of epsilon. So that's the definition of convergence then. And we say then that S is the limit n equals zero to infinity C sub n, and that's a convergent series. Now, convergent series are nice, but not all series converge. Some of them wander, others oscillate, others diverge, and then some converge. Now, if these Cn in general, of course, are complex numbers. If the sum of the absolute values converges, to something which maybe one should call S prime, then we say, so if, then, I wrote then backwards. I didn't even write it at all. That's my then. Then the series, some Cn converges, also converges, and in fact is said to converge absolutely. So that's absolute convergence. And you know many examples of infinite series. One series that doesn't diverge, that does diverge, is the inverse integers. This thing just goes to infinity, but it does so fairly gently, and in fact there's a constant called gamma, or the Euler-Mascheroni constant, and it's the limit n goes to infinity, sum k equals 1 to n 1 over k minus log n. I'm writing log from after log. I think it looks nice. And so in other words, this series diverges like the natural logarithm, or like a logarithm, which is to say slowly. And if you subtract off the logarithm and let n go to infinity, you get this Euler-Mascheroni constant, which is about 0.577 and so forth. Tests of convergence. Well, here's the standard definition of convergence that
There's some number, the number that the series converges to minus the partial sum is less than epsilon as long as n is bigger than. Obviously, there's something wrong with this definition. Namely, that if you have a series, you don't know what the limit is. And so you can't really test this. And so Cauchy, or Cauchy if you want, invented another equivalent criterion. And that criterion is that S sub n minus S sub n should be less than epsilon for n and m greater than some n of epsilon. So if the partial, if you can make the difference of two partial sums arbitrarily small by going far enough out, then the series converges, and S is then the limit of that convergent series. So let me just say a few things about tests. Suppose some Bn, and these Bn's are all greater than zero. So if you have a sum of positive terms that converges, this is sums, n equals one to infinity is some limit b of zero, say, some limit b. And if you have some complex numbers that are all less than or equal to bn, then the sum of the cn's, n equals zero to infinity, also converges to something else called C. And in fact, this converges absolutely. Why does it converge absolutely? Well, if you take the absolute value of this, there will be less than that, and these converge, so this converges absolutely. This is called a comparison test. Let me just skip ahead to something and then come back. Let's just look at a certain one minus z times one plus z squared. And if you've never seen this, you should pay a lot of attention, because it's something that's very simple and has lots of implication. You can use it for a million, it's used a million times. Okay, if you multiply this out, one times this series, you obviously get the series. You multiply times minus z, you get the series, except for the first term, and you get it with a minus sign. And you also get a new term, minus z to the n plus one. So this and, everything cancels except the two exceptional terms. And so what you get is just 1 minus z to the n plus 1. So that means that S sub n of z, which is the sum n equals 0 to capital N of z to the n, is just equal to 1 minus z to the n plus 1 over 1 minus. So what this tells you is that if the absolute value of z is less than 1, then if you let big N go to infinity, this goes to 0, obviously. And so this goes to 1 over 1 minus z. And so what you can say is that f of z is 1, less than 1, the sum n equals 0 to infinity, z to the n is 1 over 1 minus z. That's the actual convergence of that series. And now you notice something interesting. Namely, for z less than 1, the sum of this series converges to that. On the other hand, the right-hand side defines a function of z that's perfectly smooth unless z is equal to 1. That's called an analytic continuation. Let me now go back to
something called the root test, Cauchy's root test. And that is, suppose you have some terms C sub n, if C sub n is 1 over n, is less than or equal to x, which is less than 1. Well, then, the sum of C sub n is less than or equal to the sum of x to the n, and we know that this thing is 1 over 1 minus x, since x is less than 1. And so what we've got then is that this series, if you have some complex numbers, then this series, in other words, this series, converges absolutely. So this converges absolutely because the sum of the absolute values is bounded by that. So that's the ratio test, or that's the root test. This is called the root test. And there's also a, D'Alembert has a ratio test. So again, we've got the same sequence, or same series like that, if the limit as n goes to infinity of C sub n plus 1 over C sub n in absolute value, if this limit exists and is equal to r, and r is less than 1, then it converges. If r is greater than 1, it diverges. And because these days computers are so fast that you can just write a program in C, Fortran, whatever you know, or you go to Python and do something there, or MATLAB, and you just have the computer do the sum for you, and you do the sum after some capital N, and you get a number. You then do the same sum out to 10 times capital N, you get another number, and then you do 100 times capital N, you get a third number, and if these numbers are converging, you can be pretty sure that the series converges. Okay, so those are the basic things, and about just sums of numbers. Is there a question there?
Yeah, and I was wondering, could you find a function that, and like prove that it diverges the slowest of all functions?
I mean, what's the nicest divergent series?
Yeah.
Oh, well, I don't know. I thought 1 over k was pretty nice, but I don't know. You'd have to ask, I don't know, Google it. I mean, but I've never thought about it, and and you know, there may not be an answer. It may be that that there's basically an infinite sequence of functions, and that each one diverges, but diverges less than all of the ones before it, and whether that sequence converges, I just have no idea. But somebody may know, somebody who, you know, a mathematician who works on series might well have such an idea. Okay, so we can also talk about functions. Series of functions. So n equals 0 to capital N, f sub n of z. And of course this converges if s of z minus s sub n of z is less than epsilon for n greater than some n of epsilon and z in general. That's convergent. That's So if you can find an integer n that depends on epsilon and z, such that this difference is less than epsilon whenever n is bigger than that n, then the series is convergent. So that's convergent. But if you can say for n greater than just n of epsilon independently of z, then that's called uniform convergence. So this is convergence, and this is uniform. And so uniform convergence means that you can, that this number need not depend upon z. Okay, now, if you have a, we can consider integrals when can we do this? Well, it turns out we can do this a lot. And in particular, if the sequence of partial sums, if these are continuous, so all the functions are continuous, and if we have uniform convergence, then we can say that these two things are equal. A related thing is square integrable. Well, this is obvious. I mean, it's just, well, that's, we're talking about a real variable for the moment. So if you have, if a function has, if the absolute value squared of a function is integrable on a certain interval, then this thing is said to be square integrable. And if you have a, if you're talking about a sequence of square integrable functions, what you can have is convergence in the mean. And convergence in the mean means that A to B, S of X minus Sn of X, absolute value squared, dx goes to zero, the limit of this. This is convergence from the mean. So it doesn't mean that it has to happen at every point x in the interval from A to B, but the difference, the absolute value squared of the difference, has as you integrate it, has to give us zero. That's convergence from the mean. And sometimes people say, well, convergence of the mean is defined in terms of some weight function, rho of x, that is non-zero on the interval, that is positive on, well, non-negative on, positive except for isolated points on the interval, and that this is sufficient for convergence in the mean. There is one more thing to say about these things, namely, there are special functions that are particularly important, and these are called power series. So f sub n of z might be c sub n z to the n. Then the sum is s of z, and that's a sum c sub n z to the n equals 0 to infinity. So this is a power series, and to analyze it, well, then this this ratio test of
of down there is important. And so what you say then is that you want C sub n, z to the n plus 1 divided by, well, C sub n plus 1 divided by c to the n, zn. And of course, this is just equal absolute value of z times cn plus 1 over cn. And now, what you do is you're taking the limit of this as n goes to infinity, and this is said to be z over r. That is to say, r, 1 over r, is the limit as n goes to infinity of c sub n plus 1 over c sub n. So that's defined as capital R. And then what you can see is that if absolute value of z is less than r, then what we've got is that these things are, that this is a convergent sequence by the ratio test of D'Alembert. And so the power series converges. So this power series converges for absolute value z less than r. And that defines then the power series in the disk in the complex plane. And you then may be able to analytically continue it beyond that. Okay, I think I'll skip the financial example, although I recommend reading it because it takes about a minute only. All right, I didn't think I'd get this far today, but the next topic is factorials and the gamma function. I think what I'm going to do then is I'm going to erase some of the board. And while it's drying, I think I'll tell you something about Lebesgue integration and measurable sets. And by the time the blackboard is dry, we can then go on. This is rather an interesting. It's a generalization of integration, and it's a more natural definition of integration than the standard Riemann or Schiltz's definitions. And so the idea is you have some set of points, let us say, on the real line, and let's say all the points are in a finite interval, so we don't have to go nuts about infinities. So if these points are points that are on the real line in some interval between, say, A and B, then for sure the measure is less than B minus A. Or it's at most B minus A. But what you can then do is you can say, well, maybe some this set of points, I mean, it might just be one point. It might be infinitely many points. And suppose that you can find a set of intervals that contain all the points. And these intervals, you can label these intervals by, in terms of the integers. In other words, they're denumerable. You can, so you have an infinite set of intervals, and your infinite set of points are all contained in the infinite. They're all contained in the union of these intervals. Well, what you can do is you can say, for each interval that you're using to contain the points, each interval has a length. And so then you'd say the measure of the set is the sum of the length, sum of all the lengths of all the intervals, but you're looking for the lower bound of that. In other words, what would be the cheapest, suppose you had to pay for these intervals, what's the cheapest set of intervals? And you then add up the lengths of the shortest of a set of intervals, that's the measure of the set. And so, in particular, if you have any finite set of points, the measure is zero, because you can contain that then in, say, make these intervals closed intervals, so you can just have closed intervals of length zero around each of the points. And so that's the definition of measure. And now what you do the integral is very natural. What you say is you've got some function f of x, and for each value that the function takes, say it takes a value f, well, what is the set of points that maps into the value f? You take the measure of that set. And then you take the measure of all the other sets of points that map into the other values of f. And the integral, then, is the sum of those. It's the weighted average of the value of f of x times the measure of the set that goes into that value of f. That's the Lebesgue integral. It's a generalization of the ordinary integral, and it's more natural in many ways. All right. The board is dry, and I can go to factorial. N factorial is, if n is a positive integer, well, this is just n times n minus 1, dot, 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 3, 2, 1. By definition, 0 factorial is 1. That may seem weird, but in a moment, if we get to the gamma function, you'll see that that's perfectly reasonable. Now, Stirling came out with a very good estimate of n factorial. So Stirling, I don't know if this guy had anything to do with silver, Stirling silver, but in any event, he had a good estimate for the factorial. N factorial is approximately square root of 2 pi n times a rather strange thing, n over e to the n. So it's a really kind of odd function. Now, there was an Indian mathematician who was the subject of a film, The Name, Man Who Knew Infinity. Has anyone seen it? It's worth seeing. One of the characters in the book is an English mathematician, in the movie, is an English mathematician named Hardy. And by chance, I took a book out of the library on Fourier series that Hardy had written. Anyway, Ramanujan was an Indian mathematician who came to England and then got sick and went back to India and died very young and tragic. Anyway, his formula was n factorial is square root of 2 pi n, n over e to the n, and then something that no one would but him would think of, 1 plus 1 over 2n plus 1 over 8n squared to the power 1/6. And in the movie, after the Indian mathematician had died and they found out in England, got word in England that he had died, in the memorial service, one of the British mathematicians, I don't know if it was Hardy or one of the others, it was Hardy or one of the others, said that every integer was a personal friend of Ramanujan's, that he thought of every integer as one of his friends. Anyway, there's an American physicist named Merman who made some progress with n factorial. His approximation was n factorial is square root of 2 pi n, n over e to the n, e to the 1 over 12 n. So that's a very simple expression. And this is actually better than Ramanujan. And then he has a second approximation. And the second approximation is you just add terms here. Minus 1 over 360 n cubed plus 1 over 1260 n to the fifth. So that's Merman's second approximation. And he derived these from an exact formula. And the exact formula is an infinite product formula. And it's square root of 2 pi n, n over e to the n, product, j equals 1 to infinity, 1 plus 1 over j, to the j plus a half, divided by e. Okay, I don't know if I need those outer parentheses. Probably not. Anyway, that's an exact formula. Remember, as I said to you last time, we found the exact formulas, infinite product formulas for sines and cosines. I find these infinite products quite interesting. They're intrinsically more interesting than infinite sums. And in fact, half integrals, which were, I think they were originally invented by Dirac, but the person who made actual use of them and developed them was Feynman. Path integrals are expressed as infinite products. Okay, I'm 2 minutes over, so I think we should stop, unless somebody has a question. No question. All right, why don't you turn it off?